love Manny there right now. He's just so cute.
I know. I told her that. I told her. You can tell her too.
Well, just kind of help her in this business.
Can you actually sit in the middle with Jeff?
You're going to be right here?
I'll be on the end, yeah.
Where's our Indian food?
She always likes to just kind of run the camera.
Oh, because for the beginning.
And see what kind of like monkey business she can capture.
Right.
While we're unsuspecting.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I just spilled water on myself.
You can't see it. Just don't rub your dirty hands on it.
Right. Getting cozy. Poster's not gonna work.
Definitely, you got tons of room.
But Morgan has to be here, and then there's also so much camera angle.
Yeah, but Laura can fit right there.
Can you, Laura?
Testing, 1, 2, 3. Right. Testing.
Can you hear okay?
All right, say something funny. No, you don't need to shave.
Yes. Sean is a nice guy.
Okay.
Sean looks under 40.
Wowzers.
Guys, I apologize. We had no idea. He was gonna hit the sauce again. He was gonna fall off the wagon.
So, Laura Morgan, the only problem is you don't know what questions, right?
Oh, yeah, you just tell me.
We're a little disorganized, guys. Bear with us. It's an all-star cast. So, with the all-star cast come a lot of special privileges, a lot of green room stuff we had to make sure we facilitated.
Not for us.
A lot of requests, a lot of beverages.
I've been sitting out here for hours.
Beep. Hey, guys.
Hello.
Are we on?
Yes,
is this thing on?
Is this live?
Mm-hmm.
Is this on Periscope?
It's not on Periscope, no.
No.
I don't need this.
Okay, guys, so...
Why am I doing it then?
Hey, everybody. How we doing? I'd like to welcome you to the Good Dogs All-Star Cast presentation.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very special presentation in which we have the... I won't say illustrious, but that's almost too much. We've got the infamous Jeff Gellman. We've got the illustrious and talented Victoria Smith. We've got...
Stop.
Oh. Well.
We've got the lovely Laura Morgan and her nails.
Same as last week. Don't get your hopes up.
And I think I've developed a new nickname according to a few of the...
What's that?
The Savvy Sean.
Oh, the Savvy Sean. That's right. Debonair. Sexual being, Sean.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we can roll with that.
I thought your listeners were more stable. God.
Guys, when you put in this kind of time, the truth eventually rises to the top.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, anyways, everybody, welcome to the Good Dogs Q&A Saturday, episode number...
92.
You do the 9.
Jeff, do a 5.
Do a 5. Wait, what?
Jeff, do not be obstinate. 5, 6, 7, 8.
So now you have to add 3. Because that's 5. Oh, no, you add...
Tori?
What am I adding?
4, 1.
Can you put down a finger? You can't...
No, I only have 4 up.
Yeah.
5, 6, 7, 8, and then you get 1.
Cool.
She's number 1.
So they're all 9, and I'm 2, in case anyone didn't understand that.
especially me. Okay, guys, so here's the deal. We got this all-star panel. Awesome, right? Everybody knows Jeff. I think everybody knows Victoria or Tori. Oh,
yeah.
Tori's with Take the Lead Canine Training in, is it Orlando? Or are you outside of Orlando?
I'm right outside Orlando.
West of Orlando.
West of Orlando. And she's kicking ass out there west of Orlando. And Jeffrey Gellman is in Rhode Island. Mm-hmm. Excuse me. My time. Jeffrey Gellman is in Rhode Island, Providence to be exact. And we're here in Chatsworth, California. So we're also midweek. with T3 launch.
It's a little different because of T3 launch. Typically, you know, it's just Sean and I doing our thing, but since we have these lovely people here, we are going to do this. But we are, in a word, a little bit exhausted.
We're a little exhausted.
I feel fine.
A little bit drained.
Always contentious. Always like a child. Yeah, always contentious.
Depends. It depends on what day, what Jeff is going to show up. The happy-go-lucky, easygoing guy.
It could change even in the midst of the show.
It might.
Right? Unpredictable.
So we're doing this like this, and we have, what, 5 questions? Same drill.
5 questions and a half. I've got a really, really quick one that I couldn't pass up.
So we'll do normal everything. I'll ask the questions, and then we're just going to have everyone jump in. And when the timer, guys, when the timer goes off...
You go off.
Yeah.
I'm not.
All right.
And I'm looking at you, Sean.
Oh, sorry. I was trying to like stick out the higher ground and be like, listen, guys.
I love how he says,
we got a certain way that we run the show, I want to make sure that you all adhere to it.
Says, well, let's keep it short, and it freaking goes on and on and on.
The thing is, I have a lot of information to share,
but they don't proceed it with, I'll keep it short.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, I'm pulling them in. I'm pulling them in. It's the bait and switch.
Let me make a quick comment.
Okay, so but real quick, you guys want to wrap? Do you want to wrap?
See
what I got to put up with, guys?
Guys, am I right? Am I right?
Just real quick.
So, real quick, do you guys want to wrap it all about T3 launch and what's going on and the students and where we're at and what we're teaching? Anything? Anybody want to talk about it at all?
Victoria.
All right. Well, we've got 19 people.
Mm-hmm.
And today was our first day on eCaller with everybody.
Second day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's.
I think fourth day in total, right?
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Today's day 4.
3 more days.
Right. It's pretty awesome. We're seeing people that have never worked with prong collars before, never worked with eCallers before, getting their hands on dogs and getting to kind of learn about the different nuances and see how to, you know, start to take dogs from who don't know anything, moving on to a little bit more. Talent on the dogs.
Yeah.
And then I think the first day is always really special for everybody because it's the personal development business growth day.
It's where we sneak up on people.
Right. That's where it's not dog training and it's the most.
They think they're here just for the dog training.
Yeah, and the most impactful
thing. Sneak in the back door and everybody's like, Yeah.
It's pretty awesome stuff.
Yeah.
Awesome. Cool. There's Jeffrey?
Dogs are coming along. People are coming along.
Yeah.
It's fun.
We've seen some pretty awesome changes in a bunch of the dogs already, and the handlers, of course, but like we've seen several dogs that were just a day or two ago pretty nervous, kind of dicey, and already falling into line with a nice kind of calm, cool, just feeling more more chilled out, more relaxed, which is a byproduct of, I think, what all of us teach, even though we all teach slightly differently, our program and our overall kind of like foundational approach is very similar and kind of philosophically is very similar. And so I think we're seeing a lot of like typical results that we see in our board and train programs or one-on-one programs where dogs come in and they're a wreck. And then just through simple foundational exercises, we're seeing dogs like chill out and relax. And I think a lot of the owners and a lot of the or attendees are pretty surprised to see this kind of stuff go down without big fireworks, you know what I mean? Without big stuff going on. Just simple stuff like calming exercises, duration work, here's place command, but like non-negotiable. And really watching dogs kind of transform slowly into these just more chilled out animals making better choices. So.
Yeah.
Been pretty cool to see. Lots of good food as always, and some snacks that have been challenging.
Lunch has been delicious.
Has it been good?
Yeah.
I haven't been able to enjoy any of the chocolate or the cookies because they disappear rather quickly.
We'll have to see if we can do something for you about that.
I'd like to know who's responsible for that.
All I know is there was a massive, massive setup, like Watergate style setup today. When I sat down at my seat, there were chocolate covered peanut butter pretzel squares stacked up on the table next to me that I didn't place there.
Yeah.
They actually weren't stacked up. There were 16 of them to be exact, but you can't stack them. They'll tip over like the Leaning Tower of Pisa.
I wonder why you know there's 16 of them.
They were spread because I counted them just so I can literally say you ate 16 of them.
So you're claiming full responsibility.
100%.
Okay. Well, that's part of our personal development code, right?
On your chair, so.
No, it was gone too.
really?
No, the donut was out here. I had to find the donut. It was like almost like an Easter egg hunt.
So was it enough that...
Today, because you asked, you said, did you get the donut? And I was like, I've been robbed. I see Jeff with an old-fashioned donut. I'm like, this is an outrage.
So it's funny how he blames me for placing the food in front of him, but he will hunt down the junk food as well.
You just said like an Easter egg.
Yeah, so
No, you did. So anybody like, familiar with the term priming the pump?
So,
right? So let's
let he'll blame us for me. He's like on his hands and knees underneath counters looking for like.
I was only on my hands and knees for a second. I was just checking. But I'd say that I fought the good fight with those pretzels, those chocolate covered pretzels for a good while. But once they started going, they really did prime the pump. And then I almost became like I was unstoppable.
Sean is having way more fun than any of you playing Pokemon Go.
But what is that?
That's all I'm saying.
What is Pokemon Go? How come I don't know about that?
Because you
is that because I'm busy doing important projects?
Because you are on Donut Go.
Anyways, so I stumbled into the kitchen and I found an untended to Starbucks bag that happened to have an old fashioned donut in it that I think was meant for me, but never made
whether
it out
not
there.
We'll never know.
You waited anyways.
What I tried to do was consume it before anybody could catch me or come in or intercept.
Like an addict. Like, yeah.
I just wanted to make sure that I got to enjoy its full flavor and bouquet uninterrupted. Anyways, so a lot of blaming and shaming going on, even though that's what we're not supposed to be doing, but this guy, he's still got a lot of work to do. Anyways, with that said, let's jump into the show, Laura Morgan. Let's get some questions rolling. We're gonna let Tori and Jeff answer first,
really?
And then we'll come in like the cleanup crew.
Yeah, cleanup.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. We're gonna let you have the show.
Don't worry.
We're gonna give you enough rope to hang yourselves.
Should be all right.
Question number one comes from Kim. Kim says, "Hi, Sean and Laura."
Hey, Kim.
I had a question with regard to prong e-collar on small breed dogs.
Mm-hmm.
Prong is working great with my three Rotties and they're doing great, but Gizmo, my almost 10-year-old Shih Tzu, who, yep, has been a brat all of his life and allowed to get away with anything, has a few issues to work through. The biggest of which being coming when called, only when he decides to, he wants to, and food resource guarding.
Uh-oh. Gizmo.
So we have him also on a prong, but he seems to be very sensitive to it. He just fastening around his neck, he jumps back and cries out in pain. It's not tight and there's no sores or redness on his neck. I just think he doesn't want it. He's doing a good job of staying on place and then down, and when he breaks place and down, we correct him and bring him back. But I just wonder if you do any of this dance differently with a small dog versus a big dog. He's also so neurotic that when he's scared, he shakes. For example, when I'm cooking or he hears a noise outside that's loud,
Gizmo.
Almost like a seizure. It's weird. How can I stop the behavior? Thanks for your help. You guys are awesome.
So we got several things going on. So let's break it down first. Let's just jump into the prong collar thing first, right? Mm-hmm. So Gizmo, who may need to get sent to Gitmo, is having problems with...
Doesn't it say Jeff and Tori at the top?
Yeah, but I'm just giving them something to work with.
Okay,
but thanks.
Real quick. Let me make some comments real quick.
It is my show after all. And so I just wanted to make sure that these guys have something so they're not overwhelmed. So Gizmo's got issues with the prong collar. What are you guys' suggestions? He's a little dog, you know, the Rotties are doing great on the prong. What do you guys suggest with a little dog with a prong collar who's objecting to it or freaking out or crying or screaming?
Well, I don't know if anybody read the news recently, but a woman just died recently, and actually 200 Shih Tzus of hers are up for adoption. And Kim, I would highly suggest you can easily make it 201. Just slide that dog in there and no one would ever know.
And just like peel out and like...
That's right. This is the thing, Kim.
There's always more. There's always...
We didn't see.
Yeah, there's always more alternatives.
Who was counting? Were we counting on our fingers? Yeah. Do we not download the proper app?
It could have been just straight 200.
It's just too easy. So, or you can just like just swap it out and you still have 200. This is the thing, Kim. I think that your dog is most likely has a history of getting away with a lot of stuff over the last 10 or 12 years. I forgot what it was. So what you're seeing is, I want you to really, really understand that your issue is not tool-centric at all. It is Kim wants the dog to do something and the dog doesn't want to do it centric. I think if you put a slip lead on the dog, a martingale on the dog, a harness on the dog, I think the dog would object probably just as much. Because the dog does not like you finally saying, hey, little dog, I'm going to need you to do a couple of things so you can still eat and live here. I think the dog has gotten away with a lot. So I think recall does not know recall. And, you know, as you said, the dog only comes back when it wants to. That's
food and
that's
stuff
not
like that.
Recall. Yeah. That's not recall at all. So I think what you can do is you don't even have to use a prong collar on the dog, but you might as well use a small little micro prong collar, or you can use a 2.25 prong collar. The reason is because, believe it or not, it will make the learning as easiest as possible for this dog. It actually will take that, because you don't have much time. The dog's pretty old, so you gotta really speed this training up. So what I'd like you to do is
Gellman's reality check.
The Shih Tzu, 10-year-old.
Still.
But, you know, let's get this dog to introduce the prong collar. You can do the prong collar dance like you've seen in many of the videos. Definitely start out nice and easy and slow. Don't work with this dog like you're frustrated, and be careful the amount of pressure you put on the dog.
Especially compared to your Rotties.
Especially compared to your Rotties, exactly.
Yeah. Right.
So let's watch.
If there's any of this, like swinging it around, it's probably too much pressure.
Well, you probably watched one of his DVDs. So what I'd like you to do is
teach the helicopter. Okay.
What I'd like you to do is, rarely is still scary to me. What I would like you to do is actually go to solidcaninetraining.com, go to my YouTube channel, and the fourth video down actually is a Shih Tzu recall video. Okay, link that up right there.
Right.
Okay.
Not there.
But let's just train.
And let's leave some time for Miss T over here too.
All right. So what I'd like you to do is, I can't stop in the middle here. What I'd like you to do is just teach basic leashed recall. Let's teach leashed recall first. It actually is a relatively simple protocol. And you actually can use the dog's daily food. What I don't want you to use is don't use treats, just use the daily food and leash pressure, because I really want that dog to understand the leash pressure. So you're sort of psyching the dog out by saying, I'm just going to still use food, but guess what? I'm going to get you used to the leash pressure, because then when I get rid of the food, you're not going to know any.
So there's both a reward, but it's non-negotiable.
Exactly.
You got to get your butt
over
here. Tori Smith.
All right, Kim, I think at the beginning she was also talking about maybe putting this little guy on an e-collar too, right?
Yeah, absolutely, yes.
So I think that's wonderful. I love little dogs on e-collars. I find that the little guys are happier to work and a little more eager to do business with me on the e-collar, only because, again, the difference between your Rottweiler and your Shih Tzu, you know, as gentle as we try and be, you can be very gentle with e-collar pressure and wear. You know, we're strong, and you might be really strong since you're used to working with Rottweilers.
Mm-hmm.
It's a really nice way to apply very little pressure and motivate your little guy. I have to agree with, like, really like the idea of using food with your recall and everything, and working for his food. In addition to, I think we had resource guarding on top of...
Yep, on top of...
That's a whole other thing.
Yes, on top of everything, so... Controlling the resources, you know, getting him working for his food is going to get that mindset going in the right direction, and then of course addressing resource guarding by getting him e-collar conditioned is going to be really great for you.
Yeah.
Right, and I agree with Tori and with Jeff. I mean, but my major note is just I would love to see you go to e-collar training with this dog.
Absolutely.
Because then you can make the recall non-negotiable. You can easily teach the out command. We've got an out command video. If you go to the Good Dog Training YouTube, and I'll show you how to work through that. You shouldn't have to deal with any resource guarding, especially with some small teeny little guy like this. This should be like easily taken care
of. Very simple.
You don't need to deal with a bunch of, you know, monkey business, especially when you got Rotties and your Rotties are doing great and your Shih Tzu's like running the joint, like,
right.
No, let's get rid of that. So I'd highly recommend e-collar training and doing a full foundational program.
Okay.
Don't just do recall. Not that Jeff was wrong in saying that, because you wanted recall, but I would do like a full program so you really get that Shih Tzu's mind in a good space, because it sounds like Jeff was probably right on the money that the Shih Tzu is probably entitled and been doing a lot of what it wants to do for a long time. Laura Morgan, I know you don't have much time. Anything you wanted to say?
I was just going to say the big thing that you noted, you said the thing about the dog being nervous around sounds and nervous around cooking.
Yeah.
that's not a comfortable dog, yep. right? So when you're doing this, you know, when the dog's fronting with all this other stuff, oh, resource guarding, oh, I don't want to come near you, or oh, I don't want to be trained, all this stuff. Like, just remember that working through that is going to make your dog more comfortable, which, like,
right.
you shouldn't, your dog shouldn't be uncomfortable when you're cooking
right.
or there's a loud noise. That sucks for the right. dog. So when you're doing it, and it's like, because this, I don't know why my gut tells me this is going to be a tough one for you, just in general, like a tough, a 10-year-old.
It's one of those Laura insights where she, like,
this she's been a hard ass with her Rotties, and she's let the Shih Tzu get away with everything.
Yeah, and that's yep. totally fine. I just feel like this dog might be a tough
yep.
customer.
Yep.
So every time you start to feel your will to train start to wane, think about your dog being uncomfortable.
Right.
And use that as your motivation. You know what? I know I got to push through this
yes.
for you.
And that's a great point, because I think a lot of people only look at the discomfort they're getting from
yeah.
the dog,
right.
and they forget about the discomfort that the dog
right.
is in. And Laura's always great at reminding us about that.
You might think that your Shih Tzu is in during the training period, your dog's already
right.
uncomfortable.
You can't yeah. match
right.
how uncomfortable
right.
it is.
All you can do is make it better.
Right. Yeah. And one yeah. more helpful hint too on recall, if you strap the Shih Tzu to the Rotty, call the Rotty back, your Shih Tzu will have a bomb-proof recall.
I love that. I think that's a great idea
right.
around the house.
Especially if the Rotty's really well behaved.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Well, I'm assuming that our Rotties are like really well trained.
Okay, so we've got a 6-month-old GSD that's becoming territorial, bratty, and possessive.
Let me just, I'll just jump in. Shall I?
Sure.
Oh, I was just briefing. Yeah.
Oh, oh.
Jump in. Do your thing, lady.
You want to continue briefing?
Oh, no. I was forgetting that the cameras, I figured you'd cut that out, and I was just behind.
Oh,
this was
oh,
behind
oh.
the scenes.
Go for it. Okay. I thought
no.
you thought I already asked.
No, go ahead.
Okay. Question number two comes from Anne. Anne says,
hey, Anne.
Hi, Sean and Laura. My 6-month-old GSD comes to work with me daily in an open office environment where there's like 80 to 100 people.
Wow,
and
cool.
He's always been laid back and chill in the office. He's very social and always so well behaved there. We have a young lady with disabilities, some cerebral palsy, and I think and perhaps some other issues who loves him. Recently, whenever she approaches my desk, he barks at her with hackles raised. He only does this when she comes to my desk, not if he approached her at the desk in the cafeteria area. I surely don't want to endanger the little girl, and it's a privilege to be able to bring him to work. I don't want to screw it up for us or others who bring their dogs. Yesterday, he did the same thing to two other co-workers who we already had seen several times during the day, so it's not just her.
Yep.
Outside of work, he's bold and pushy. He bullies our 9-year-old GSD, biting her neck, face, and legs like he was a wolf and she was a deer to be taken down. She's always
wow. comfortable
with other dogs, but he seems to be fearful of him when he starts this shit. Mm. He doesn't do that if they're both on leash, only if he's leash or if they're both loose. All of this just started recently. Not sure if he feels like he has to guard me at my desk. He's enrolled in a training program and has also been to their day school program once a week for a couple months. Help.
I'd be so curious what kind of training program that is,
yeah.
first and foremost. Just let me, before we jump into these guys, I'd love to find out, Anne, if it's a food protocol, like positive only, just rewards-based training, or if you're using actual tools for a shepherd that would be more appropriate, like leash and prong or any e-collar work or anything like that. So hit us back with some info about that. And with that, Jeffrey, Tori, take it.
Sorry.
Well, you've got a German Shepherd dog who is bred to be protective, but not against your fellow workers, not especially not against somebody with cerebral palsy, absolutely not towards people, you know, guests in your home. As an owner of 4 German Shepherd dogs, which has nothing to do with it, but also working line dogs and dogs that actually are trained to bite, would never do this behavior at all.
Right.
In the workplace. I think you are spot on that you and your dog, this is not guilt, can actually destroy the animal-friendly policy at your workplace. So the cool thing is that you have an animal-friendly policy at your workplace, so let's keep it that way, because boy, would I hate to see your German Shepherd dog not come to work with you and have to be home all day. So let's do this. It's going to get worse if you don't address it. So if anybody tells you that the dog will get better as it gets older, maybe around the 12 to 13 year old mark, we might see some improvement.
If it's got wheels for back legs.
Right, we might see some improvement if we don't address it now. And I'm saying that seriously because that is common.
Yeah.
Especially if you're in a training program where they're not using tools that are going to work on a dog like this, it's easy to say, like, it's your fault.
Right.
Yeah.
It's the other people's fault.
Don't you dare let anybody at that training program tell you, like, well, you know, there's nothing you can do about this. Yeah. You just got to manage it, put them away, or anything like that.
Also, the dog does not need more exercise. So if you ran that dog 10 miles before work, it would most likely still do the same displaying of unacceptable behavior. And then eventually, after 2 months, you'll have an athlete on your hands.
A marathon won't stop him from guarding?
No, which is nice. So what I want you to do is this. Your dog needs to understand what yes and what no is. Mm. And your dog needs to understand what's acceptable and what's not acceptable. So I'm going to suggest that you don't use the workplace right now as the training ground. Let's use out of the workplace as the training ground. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like the dog is displaying some of these behaviors out of the workplace. So what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to get, you know, one of our videos. Sean has got a fantastic remote collar training DVD. Remember, remote collars are not just for no, they're also for yes. What you'll be doing is you'll be fully training your dog on all the basic commands with a high emphasis of the place command and then how to correct a dog for non-compliance.
And probably recall as well, so you can
exactly. So then what I want you to do is start educating that dog what you want and what you don't want. Also, believe it or not, what I'd like you to do is don't let people pet the dog in the workplace. You're there to work, the dog is there to work. Now, that does not mean never, but when you're at your desk, I absolutely do not want this dog to think that every single person that walks by or approaches you is a potential friend or foe. Mm-hmm. I want this dog to actually think that they're a non-existent
thing. None of their business.
It's none of their business at all. So now it's going to put you in a hard spot of saying, no, you can't pet my dog. Which might be hard for the special needs person because this person probably likes the dog, but unfortunately your dog has not earned the right to say hello. So what we're going to do is we're going to put a hiatus on the hellos from everybody, even the people that actually get along with the
dog. Don't you think maybe hiatus on work?
It depends. It depends like what kind of training they're doing. It depends. Right. It depends what kind of effect they're having. One thing I wanted to add is that it's a 6-month-old shepherd, so it's like this is age-appropriate crappiness, right?
Right.
It's typical to see a shepherd at 6 months start to give you all sorts of monkey business. Yeah. Doesn't mean it's right, but it means it's time, like Jeff said, to start adding training, structure, rules. Yes, no. This is okay. This is not okay. Here's accountability. Here's consequences for inappropriate behavior.
Right.
So if that dog is at your desk, down the line, eventually, if your dog is to be growling at anybody or taking exception with anybody, your dog should be corrected and let know straight away, do not. That's none of your business. How dare you growl? How dare you bark? How dare you be offended by anybody? It's not your job to protect or be possessive or territorial of me here. This is my office. You zip it up.
Right.
So that's something I feel pretty strongly about, making sure they understand that what's going on is it's not that your dog is like turning into some monster. It's that you're moving out of puppyhood into adolescence, and you're going to start to see more of the true dog come out.
It's gotten a lot of like kind of freedoms with like work time is a privilege, you know? So, yeah, I think it sucks that we don't know what training's going on. You know?
Yeah, but like, start with prong collar, move to e-collar, and like do a full program with this dog, and have this dog highly trained and highly accountable, and then you can have a shepherd that's in a great space. But I'm telling you, we get shepherd after shepherd after shepherd, as I'm sure everybody here does, that have not been told what's appropriate and what's not appropriate, and so their natural genetics, their DNA kicks in and says, I'm going to protect, I'm going to possess, I'm going to guard, I'm going to do all this, and most of them are nervous and insecure about it, so they make bad choices, they're not prepared to assess and make good choices. So that's on you to lead and guide your dog rather than let your dog make these choices. Tori, I'm sorry if I kind of eat up all your time.
That's okay. I was going to talk about the behaviors with the adult dog at home, too.
Cool. So, nail it.
Yes, yeah, so we've got like a pushy, you know, young teenage age, right?
I totally forgot about that. Yeah.
So just, you know, and we usually see like correspondence of pushy, kind of bratty stuff happening, probably at home. You didn't really go into much of your home life with your dog, but if she's constantly pestering, or he is constantly pestering your older dog, we have to make sure that we advocate for the older dog and address that.
Absolutely.
Your older dog walking through the house and constantly being nipped at and pestered is just another opportunity for your shepherd to be doing something inappropriate, and it all like...
And getting away with it.
Exactly. Yeah, it all comes full fold back to he's growling at the workplace. He shouldn't be doing that. Well, he shouldn't be, you know, your older dog is sending signals, and if your young guy isn't getting it, you've got to step up and address that. And again, structure in the house, e-collar training, creating like a household management program where he's learning impulse control and learning how to be calm around your other dog. A lot of young dogs don't know how to be calm around other dogs, and that's a huge element of the issue you may be having between him and your 9-year-old shepherd.
And just to kind of build off that, if you were to correct your dog significantly for being a jackass to the other dog, you might see a lot of the other problem behaviors go away,
right?
All of these things are connected, just like Tori's saying. So if your dog's being a bully inside the house, let's get rid of the bullying inside the house. You're probably gonna see a lot of other things get better. Now, how do you do that? The simplest, quickest, easiest way is a leash and prong on your dog inside the house, and let that dog drag that leash and prong around. You see your dog misbehave, bully, push, pressure your other dog, you say no, and you give him a nice firm pop, and you let him know that doesn't fly in this house, and watch your dog's behavior start to change.
Yeah. Also, make sure you're crating your dog at night, crating your dog when you're not away, and obviously it's going to be a given, you're going to fully train this dog. So pretty much, this is show number 92, go back to the last 91 shows, and you want to be doing everything about this. I'm sure that Sean and Laura talk about this all the time, but whenever anybody asks one question and they give them an answer about that specific behavior, that doesn't mean you don't do all the other stuff you're supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
So, same thing with this, you know, got a 6-month-old dog, make sure you're fully training it. Real training where it's going to be eventually off-leash trained, and not by the time it's 3, but actually by the time it's 1-year-old.
Yeah, if this dog's roaming through the house with no structure, you're in big trouble, right? Yeah. If you got a young, pushy, bratty shepherd that's just roaming around, none of us would allow that. Should be crated when unsupervised, should learn play straight away. That dog needs to learn that you run that house and that he doesn't.
Now, we have 6 minutes, we've gone over, but almost every one of these questions is actually a 1-hour answer.
Yeah, right.
So just keep that in mind.
So you have to do the work and really research back to get all the details.
Exactly.
The details.
Okay.
You allow her to ask questions on this?
Who's it from?
Coral Lee up in Canada.
She needs help.
She's a T3 student.
She needs help.
She can't do Q&A.
It's a lifeline.
She knows how to... She's
reaching out.
She's supposed to know how to do all this. Coral Lee, no questions.
T3 isn't exhaustive.
What's that?
I love you, Coral Lee.
Yeah, we love you.
So we do love you.
I love Coral Lee. She's been to 2 RVs, 1 T3.
And she needs a little help.
She needs a little help.
All right, Coral Lee.
She says, hi, guys.
Hi, Coral Lee.
She didn't say that to me.
It was question number 3, guys. Okay. Hi, I'm back. She said.
we heard.
She knows. She knows. She knows exactly what's going on.
Quick question on recall. My good old Chet recalls pretty much 100%.
Is Chet the dog that was at T3?
Yep.
Okay,
awesome.
Pretty much 100% inside with distractions.
Nice.
He makes eye contact and is asking me for information.
Awesome. You're not going to like the rest.
When it comes to outside, he's about 60%
That's
reliable.
It? That sucks.
Coralie!
Which we are working on. But unless I recall him from a down stay, I get 0 engagement from him. He will come, but sniff the floor, look around, with absolutely no hurry. I've tried to get more engagement by using his daily food, but without success, what would you guys do? Thank you so very much. I miss you both, but all of you.
She means just Sean and Laura is what
she doesn't
mean.
Know everyone's here. All right, Coralie.
All right.
And I'm going to say her last name right. It's
Evoquez.
No, it's not. I call her Evoquez, but it's actually Evocu.
Is it really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
French. Yeah,
she's French.
And didn't I call her like first name when she was at T3, like Corina or something like
that?
Yeah, Coraline. Yeah, she really like she
she's
was she hated me deeply.
To me, but it's Coralie Evocu.
It's so pretty.
Okay.
Isn't that pretty?
That is pretty. Yeah. Now, if we can get this recall pretty, we'll be in business. Jeffrey. Okay.
6 minutes on the clock.
Yeah,
boogie. 60%.
You need 30 seconds for this one. It's all you need.
60%, Coralie. Sucks. Okay.
I agree.
Bottom line, aren't you remote collar training this dog?
He's remote collar trained.
Then what is going on? So this is what I want you to do.
Remember when he growled at everyone?
That's right. So
he was bad news bears at T3.
All right. This is what I'd like you to do. Seriously.
Just to be clear to the audience, he's a tough dog.
Yeah. Yeah. She was on a bus, right? Yes. Or you moved him to a bus.
Yeah. And he's he's a tough customer.
All right. So
not just like a golden retriever.
If this was your client's dog, what would you tell your client? And what you'd probably tell your client is this: dial up. Start at a higher level, keep the dog on a long line. The first couple of times that the dog didn't recall, and for everybody out there that's brand new to recall and brand new to the learning curve and the stages of learning, Coralie is actually at the correction stage, meaning the dog doesn't need to be prompted, she actually doesn't need to use food.
She's already trained what the behavior means. Right. Dog's crystal clear on right. what it means.
She doesn't have to be like, come on, let's go. That's over.
They're out of kindergarten.
Okay, it is. What's
college.
The dog's name?
They're in college.
Chet. So it's Chet here, Chet come, dog doesn't comply, high level on the remote, the dog's going to go, what the Frank Sinatra was that? And then you are going to get that dog to come back to you. And what you're going to do is this, you're going to do 5, 10, 15, 25, meaning you're going to have the dog, you just tell the dog to wander off.
Break.
At 5 meters away, the dog comes back to you. At 10 meters away, the dog comes back to you. 20 meters away, the dog comes back to you. And you are going to do repetition after repetition after repetition. I want that dog, when it hears your voice on recall, it spins around on a dime. How are you going to do that? You're going to do that with a higher level on the remote. So at this point, you're actually punishing the act of non-compliance. The dog is going to be
laziness, distraction, yes. blowing you off, not prioritizing you.
So this is not a dog, for all the audience out there, this is not a dog that does not know recall. No. This is a dog that is making a very conscious decision to say,
I was going to do the same thing. You beat me to it.
Just to clarify, we know this dog very well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I loved everything except the metric system. I was lost.
That she's in.
You've been in Canada a long
she's
time.
She's in Canada.
Oh, you were just translating for the Canadians. Okay. Awesome. You're a master. Okay. Wow, I was lost. But okay. Tori, what would you like to say?
Do you realize that most of the world doesn't do our measuring system?
Yeah.
Like most of the world does
America.
Metric.
I live here.
Okay.
America.
But I'm a worldwide.
I know.
I'm a worldwide dog trainer.
Jeff said it all right. And if you're doing, as Jeff says, more than likely, you're not going to get the sniffy on the way back, the blowing you off. But just something to add, if you were to get any kind of like aloofness to go sniff a bush or sniff the ground,
What is this?
That's the button.
That's the universal term.
Oh,
for
I didn't know if it was a metric thing or something. a metric hand signal.
This means correct.
We correct again and
we correct.
It speeds up. And if it continues to sniff,
this is the universal sign for correction.
Right. Yeah. So the reality is, and this can transfer for owners beyond Coralie,
Evoku.
Okay, it's Canadian. French Canadian. Anybody else who's done the complete process of training their dog recall and are having issues with lazy recall, distracted recall, blowing off recall, not prioritizing your recall, but you've done it all and your dog knows crystal clear what you're looking for, then you do need to raise the levels. Like Jeff said, have the dog on the long line to make sure that you absolutely get compliance, that the dog can't run anywhere else, can't freak out, but start saying like, the levels of consequence and accountability are going to start to come up in order to make sure that we get what we're looking for right. because the dog's making bad choices.
Right. And I want you also to now look at your numbers on your remote. I want you to watch that dog, and if that dog doesn't go, holy shit, I better get my derrier back to Coralie, then your level's not high enough.
Yeah. Okay. You should see rockets come out of his behind.
Right. Flames, right? Okay. This is Canada Day, every day.
Okay, and the thing is, Coralie, like the food stuff with the dog like this.
For drop it.
Yes.
No food.
Are you kidding me?
No.
Like, is she leaving like a trail of breadcrumbs to like, come on, Coralie.
Skittles all over.
Come on.
This is actually a good thing to bring up because it's hard. Like, okay, I'm going to add daily food. Like you were just talking about daily food.
Yeah,
right?
Not with this dog.
But
yeah.
It depends on attitude. And this is what we talk about much. Right, Laura, explain why food wouldn't be good with an attitude-rich dog.
Because you're basically like, well, I don't want to say bribing because it's not the bribe.
No.
But you're actually like
there's just a flavor to going, oh, please come.
That's like, what it is.
Just give me this. So with another dog that needs like a little bit more stuff, or like an older dog, right. Like a million other dogs except Chet. Yep.
Every dog but Chet.
Yeah. Chet has an attitude that's definitely like, you are soft and really a weak person that I don't follow.
Yes.
And that's Chet's, not because yeah. you, Coralie. You're a strong person.
Yes.
But Chet would boss me around like right. that.
He'd she's CrossFit. Like
yeah. She's
CrossFit. Yeah.
Yeah. Lay some CrossFit on his ass.
Yeah. Seriously.
He's one of those guys who it's a tough dog with a female owner, to yes. be perfectly honest right. with you.
Yeah.
So you need to bust some ass with like, No. We don't give you food for something you've been learning for a year and I've gone to 3 seminars right, right. for. No, we're done with all that.
This is a dog, and this is very rarely do I say this, because this is old school. But this is a dog. What's the reward for coming back to you? I didn't correct you. That's the reward. Like, that's really the reward.
That's kind of a good mindset for Chet
yeah,
to be in.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And Laura, you've even, like, with certain clients, female clients that are getting blown, because we see this,
yes.
right? Where dogs make distinctions about female. Right. You live that reality.
Right, right.
But you've recommended multiple times with female clients versus male clients yeah. when we're dealing with family dynamics.
No, girl levels.
Uh-huh. And why is that?
Because the dog is just like, they don't buy it from the owner, from the female owner. They just need the higher level to actually buy in. So the owner is the same height as the male, same, knows how to press the button, but maybe the timing's even better.
They wear the same dress size, everything.
Same shoe size, same high heels yep. in right, the session, right. but still, they need a higher level because the dog
maybe the dog's just confused. It felt like a tough household.
It's fundamental energy. Yeah. It's not yeah. so much like about like, oh, females are weak. It's
not at all.
You've got yeah.
a giant pity, whatever he is. He's like this big dude, and he's got a really strong mind.
And I'd give a million zillion dollars to know what the very, very early programming and interactions were between Coralie and
I know what they are. That's why we're suggesting all
okay,
this
okay, so I don't know.
I don't know.
I would love to know.
You know.
Because I think that's where it's all you coming know. From.
All right, Coralie, we
right.
love you.
We love you. Bust
we love yes. you.
And his rear.
Yeah. Right.
Okie dokes. All right, so we've got...
Jeffrey, get off of your social
question
media.
Question number 4 comes from Chrissy, spelled K-R-I-C-Y.
I've never seen Chrissy spelled that way.
Yeah, she says, maybe it's pronounced different, but... She says, hello, your page was recommended to me by a friend when I expressed some major concerns with my rescue. I've had Abby now for almost 4 years. She has some boxer in her, but not sure what else. I rescued her from a pet rescue who rehabbed her after finding her beaten badly and left for dead on the side of the road in Florida.
Mm-hmm.
My son had been begging for a dog, and she looked like a great dog to protect my home and bring into the family. She obviously had a rough puppyhood, but it's not known to what extent fully. She'll be 6 in November, and her aggression has gotten gradually worse over the years. She is dangerous. I can't have friends over, and neither can my son. Her food aggression and toy aggression has even gotten to the point where she will lunge out if we, my son and I, walk near her things. She's a very loving dog, though, too. She's protective of my son and I. I am not scared of her exactly like my friends and family are. I work 24-hour shifts as a firefighter, so she uses a doggy door to let herself out when I'm gone, but I fear if she was ever to get out while I was home, she would attack someone. She has bitten family members, attacked cats and people while taking her on walks. The vet recommended Xanax. It's not helped.
For the owner, for the dog.
I'm surprised the vet didn't recommend euthanasia.
Yeah.
Yes.
I could keep going, but the question is, why does her aggression and anxiety get worse after being loved for 4 years?
Okay.
But before, yeah. Hang on.
It's their first time on the page.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, shit. I have to be nice to her?
Yes. Yes.
She's very nice.
God.
This is huge.
Chrissy, hang tough. Hang tough with us.
She's a liability. I'm afraid I might have to surrender her, which breaks my heart because I know she'll be put down. I can't afford to pay $100 an hour for dog therapy. There has to be some answer, but I miss having my friends over and my 10-year-old son wants to have sleepovers.
Okay.
Let me add, she is a good
dog to us also.
Okay.
I'm going. But
hang on a sec, Jeffrey. No, I'm just on Jeffrey then.
I'm not saying anything.
Yeah, he's off, Jeff.
I haven't said a word.
You're going to.
I'm not even thinking.
He's like Mount Vesuvius. He's
right
going to explode.
You're about to explode.
Hang on, Chrissy.
She's
we're going to be okay.
She's a great cuddler and a total mama's girl. She seems happy and wags her tail constantly. I'm just laughing because you're acting.
Because the heat's emanating.
She's so funny and really does bring joy to us, but the negatives are almost outweighing the positives.
Almost?
I knew who was going to say that. I'm not laughing at you, Chrissy. I'm
hang in there, Chrissy. Just bear with us.
Okay. It's not a funny thing. I had a dog, very similar stuff, but it was like I cried every day, all day.
So yeah, we've all been through bad dogs.
The negatives are almost outweighing.
I'll be nice.
She cowers at the vet and groomers, but no one has been able to cut her nails in almost a year, but I love her. I'm so lost.
Okay.
But there was also talk about a vet behaviorist.
She said, I don't have $100 for
it. No, but...
Oh, and then Amanda just read that. Said you should dig deep into Sean's Facebook page. He'll give you some ideas, you know, blah, blah, blah. Amanda Moran, who we love. Chrissy said, I met with an obedience trainer who does in-home training with the e-collar, etc. I also met with a vet behaviorist, and she suggested weeks of therapy and medication and said obedience training is abuse. I don't know that I agree with either.
Really? It's going to get worse.
I don't know that I agree with either method. I've been diagnosed with anxiety myself in the process of trying medication after medication. Having to wait weeks for results was devastating and frustrating. Okay. I can't see putting my dog through that. But then the military style training scares me also. I'm not sure what to do. I feel backed into a corner.
Okay. All right.
And then Mark says there's a trainer in Florida who basically recommends Tori.
What?
Okay.
Non-military training.
Okay, so.
So we got to really unpack this and break it apart.
I'm going to
give this one 7 minutes.
Okay, I will start this and it's Chrissy?
Chrissy.
Okay, yeah. Chrissy.
First time here.
Yeah, so be nice to Chrissy.
Okay. Chrissy?
She's in a lot of.
I'm just a guest here. I'm not Sean or Laura. If you don't like my answer, please still follow them. I'm not mad at you. I love you and I feel for you.
Yes.
And I'm 100% being serious, and it might come across as mean and non-caring. First of all, the good thing is, this is Tori, okay? And
she's a military operation.
She will help you. Number one, all the information you've gotten from all the other professionals is outright blatantly wrong, bordering on ethics. For anybody to say that obedience training is abuse is actually ignorant and stupid.
And you're going to hear it from every veterinary behaviorist. Okay.
So this is what I want you to do. First of all, I don't care where your dog came from. You got it at 2. You've had it for 4 years. All due respect, you have created this problem, and I'm not saying that to shame or blame you. I'm actually saying that as a positive, because that means you can fix this problem. Mm-hmm. This has got nothing to do with the dog's past. This has actually probably a lot to do with the last 4 years. Okay? The fact that you think this is a great dog is actually also creating the problem. I want you to know that maybe your dog is great, but currently today, 2016 in July, you actually do not own a great dog. I'm sure there are moments that are great, but it absolutely does not get a free pass for all of the dangerous, almost lawsuit, losing your house.
Aggression.
Life-threatening mm-hmm. stuff. Someone will get highly injured and the dog actually
it'll come down on you.
It will be killed, okay? Yeah. So, what I want you to do is this. I want you to stop thinking your dog is wonderful and cute and cuddly. You actually should not be giving this dog any affection right now at all. We're not talking forever. The dog is 6. You're going to have 8 to 9 years left of this dog's life if you fix it, 8 to 9 weeks if you don't fix it. I specialize, as well as Sean does and Laura, in aggression rehab. So I see the dogs like yours every day, and I see wonderful owners like you every day who just don't know. You've dug yourself into a very big ditch and you don't know how to get out. But yeah. I want you to know I have all the tools to get you not only out of the ditch, but to build a beautiful home on top of that ditch. What I want you to do is cut out all the love and affection. I want that dog in a crate. I want that dog in a crate. Now, the problem is when you work your 24-hour shifts, allowing that dog in and out of the doggy door is actually way too much freedom. But let's put that aside from right now, but I'd love to find a great way that you didn't have to do that. And maybe with your son, but he's 10 years old, so maybe he's not home alone. I'm not sure what happens when you work those 24-hour shifts. But giving your dog that kind of freedom has got to stop. That dog should be in a crate at night when you sleep, in a crate when you are not home. You need to train that dog on the minimum basics of obedience, which is walking on a leash politely. When the dog walks on a leash politely next to you, no lunging, no barking, no growling, no sniffing, no marking. It can't be lunging at people. It can't be lunging at other dogs. I want you to remote collar train that dog. It is not military style dog training. It is not.
Let me interrupt. If you are talking to a trainer who is a military style dog trainer, who is training police dogs and personal protection dogs,
right,
then don't go with that trainer, right? There are military style trainers out there, but just because someone's using a prong or an e-collar does not make them a military style trainer. But if you are seeing somebody like that, that's not who you want.
Right.
They don't specialize in behavior modification.
Right. Also, to give you a heads up, all of those dogs' bad behaviors and those unwanted and dangerous behaviors are going to have to be punished. They will. I will tell you right now, those behaviors will be punished. It is not mean. It is not abusive.
You will not fix those behaviors with love.
It's
you inquired that, like, I don't understand. She's been loved for all these years, and why is she getting worse?
I totally get that. Like, what do you mean? I've given you this home. How could you act?
But
like
that's not what your dog needs, and that's the big gap. The big chasm here is that most owners think that a dog that's had a rough past or any past, if I love them right, they'll get healthy, they'll get happy, they'll be balanced, they'll respect us, they'll treat us nicely, but that's not the case. That's not what's going on. You're actually loving your dog into a space of more anxiety, more stress, more aggression, more fear, more whatever it is. So the love is not going to fix this, and that's one of the most important things I can get across to you.
It is impossible. Also, I want you to remember, you are a firefighter. When a house is on fire, you climb up the ladder, you get on the roof, and you put holes in the person's roof. When the house is not on fire, you are not doing that, correct? But you're still a firefighter, meaning there are going to be a time and a place that you are going to be putting holes in roofs. At most of your life, you are not. With your dog, there is going to be a time and a place that you will be correcting slash punishing the inappropriate behavior. That does not make you a mean dog owner. It doesn't. 3% of your life with that dog is going to be punishment based.
Are you saying you put holes in the roof in order to save the structure, in order to do the stuff that's hard and might seem damaging, but is actually saving the complete picture?
Exactly.
Gotcha.
97% of the time with your dog, though, is going to be structure and loving, but not the loving that you have been doing. Not that physical affection.
Loving through guidance.
Cuddling. Right. Mm-hmm. So what I'd like you to do is I would like you to read at least the last 10 to 12 blog posts that Sean has done, which actually don't even include training tools, most likely. What I'd like you to do is watch all of his YouTube videos on how to do basic training. What I want you to do is cut out all affection and put up massive structure. I want you to
Can you explain to her what structure would look like?
Structure would look like, well, your fire truck is structured. When the fire alarm goes off, you have it. You literally know exactly by muscle memory what you will be doing
where everything's at.
You're gonna go in
everything.
Truck.
Right.
When you approach that building that is on fire, everybody works as
game
a team.
Game plan. Yeah.
Everybody works as a team, and you have practiced and practiced and practiced and practiced.
Imagine if you showed up at a fire and you didn't have a game plan, and it wasn't structured, and you didn't know where everything was. Imagine how stressed and freaked out and overwhelmed you'd be.
Right.
So the structure inside your house, like Jeff's talking about, the dog's got to be crated. The dog needs to learn how to be in a place command. Place command is going to be essential to changing so much of this behavior. But what we're talking about right now is not going to make any sense to you unless you, because somebody I think just recommended our page, so I think this is brand new if I'm not mistaken, right? So none of this is going to make any sense until you do what Jeff is suggesting, which is dive in and educate yourself about how the psychology of this works, how the training, how the mechanics work, all of that stuff. You need to have all of that on board so you can really move forward in an educated fashion. And Tori, were you saying that Tori is in her hood?
Yeah, I mean, she's in Florida. I don't know where exactly she is in Florida.
So Tori, chime in and help this lady out.
So this is your first time to the Good Dog page, so definitely check out the blogs. Like, they will answer so many questions.
TheGoodDogLifeBlog.com.
Yes.
If you want to find it.
And it, like Jeff said, I don't even think they talk about tools because there's an entire psychology behind the way that we love our dogs. And I find that a lot of like my clients and I'm sure they're clients. We get these phone calls all the time about dogs who have had bad pasts. We know the story. They get the dog. And unfortunately, you feel really bad about what happened, and we share a lot of really soft and sensitive energy. And if you can imagine being that dog and going to a new place, a new home, a new location with different people that you don't know, you don't speak English, and all you see are really soft and vulnerable people who feel sorry, like, and it's because you feel sorry for the dog, you now have a dog who is concerned. You have a dog who doesn't feel like...
He's got no one to lean on.
No one to lean on, and yeah. All of a sudden we put all, unintentionally put all this weight on our dog to, and you mentioned kind of beginning, be protective, to protect our home. And we unintentionally create these really unstable guard dogs because your boxer mix is not bred to be a guard dog.
You did mention that you wanted a dog to protect your home. Guess what?
That's what
when dogs get stressed and anxious, they engage in all sorts of behaviors that are really, really, really unfortunate.
Right.
And the way we remove stress and anxiety is through training, structure, leadership, and guidance. It's what all of us do.
Right.
And if you want to make that happen, what I'd really like you to wrap your head around is that this can be sorted out,
mm-hmm.
that it's not a lost cause, but you do have to do a hell of a lot of work to educate yourself so you can make good decisions about how to move forward.
Right.
Contacting Tori at taketheleadcaninetraining.com would be a great place to start to get good information and to get guidance, and then you can move from there.
And I will mention two things that either make you either give me the finger or it'll make you cry with happiness. Number one, I have got two seminars coming up in Florida, one in Ellenton, Florida, and one in West Palm Beach. And you can have a free ticket.
There you go.
There you go.
You can't give the finger to that, right? So
I don't want to see this dog dead.
Yeah.
I just don't.
So
I don't. Let me finish though.
How can she contact you?
Go to solidcaninetraining.com. But also you want to contact Tori as well. But also, if you are literally saying these guys are full of, I want you to know, between the three of us, we've trained 10,000 dogs, most of them with aggression. This is what we do for a living. So a couple of things. Do not put your dog on medication. It will not help. If you decide to blow all of this information off and say, these guys are crazy, I would never do that to my dog, I'm going to go down a different avenue. You can, but please do not put your dog down unless you have taken our suggestions. They will work, but you got to go all in.
Mm-hmm.
You got to go all in. I
and
want
it
you
might
to know,
be counterintuitive initially for
we
you.
We see yeah. dogs like yours all the time,
mm-hmm.
and we're telling you, I don't want to use the word fixed. I hate that word.
Yeah.
But boy, can we get you the dog that you want? Mm-hmm. I want you to know that, okay? But it's going to take a lot of change, and I think about 90% of that's going to be with you.
And Chrissy, my main note here to myself is that we see dogs like this all the time.
All the time.
All the time. That's all we primarily
that's
what see.
That's how we make actually a really good living.
Right? So anybody who's telling you that it can't be fixed or wants to put your dogs on meds doesn't understand how to move the dog through a program like this and how to get a dog into a better space. So we're not trying to sell you anything. You don't need to buy anything from us.
I've given you something for free.
Just go after the information and educate yourself, and then you can make an informed decision from there. Cool?
Right. Thanks,
Chris. Let us know.
Good luck. Hang in there.
Okay.
All right, guys.
Question number
this is
five.
A jamming show.
Jamming.
Full of drama and peaks and valleys.
I'm sorry. I'm emotional. I'm pregnant.
There's so many good questions on here.
Yeah.
Just reading them.
That's what I'm telling you. It was so hard to go through those. I may end up answering more of these questions
Amanda,
on my own.
You could do a Periscope, like Amanda Moran, Wendy. Okay. Question number five comes from Tracy. Tracy says, hey guys.
Hey, Tracy.
I bought the Foundation Prong DVD and I've been working on it with my 18-month-old German Shepherd for about a week.
Awesome.
She's gentle and respectful, but has two issues we're working on. Major barking at the door and major leash reactivity to other dogs.
Hmm.
Walking her is fine until we see another dog, and then fireworks. Our problem is that she seems to be afraid of her prong collar. When I get out to put it on her, she slinks around like she's in trouble and trembles when it's on.
Hmm.
From the first day we used it, she seemed so sensitive to it that I've been afraid to leave it on her all the time. The collar has been great when I walk her. I only have to use gentle leash pressure when she starts to pull and she stays right beside me. I've been careful to avoid other dogs so far so I don't have to give her a pop because I'm afraid she's already afraid of it. I'm wondering if this is normal or if she'll get used to it. Pretty sure I have it sized right for her. Thanks for your good work. Love your videos.
Thank you so much, Tracy.
All right.
Jeffrey, you want to jump in real quick?
I think I'll let Tori start on this one.
Jump in real quick?
Okay. So, I think it's great that you are using the DVDs and you're getting started. German Shepherds are very vocal dogs in general.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
German Shepherd. Mm. And so they're very vocal and can be very sensitive dogs.
Super vocal.
Yeah, super vocal.
Which could cause somebody to really think their dog is freaking out.
Yes, to really.
Or in pain.
Yes. Yeah. They're just generally exceptionally vocal creatures. Mm-hmm. I think that it's important to acknowledge how great your walks have been, how much better those things have improved before we look at what we've got when you bring out your training equipment. Mm-hmm. A lot of times we express energy and emotion towards our dog, and if you have begun to feel like, I don't think she likes your training stuff, when you're getting the equipment out, there's a good chance that you're probably kind of issuing that kind of energy, which is probably affecting the way that your shepherd is feeling about the tools coming out. And the big thing is, a lot of dogs are uncomfortable with a lot of things. Another quality of many dogs, but sometimes German Shepherds, they can be just a little bit nervous and a little bit unsure and skittish and sensitive dogs about stuff. The cool thing is, we kind of just batten down the hatches and work through it. We stay confident. We continue with our training. You're not just training on walks. Do your obedience stuff inside with your equipment on, and let her experience wearing the collar, not just on your walks, and not, you know, and you got to be careful to not do like big amounts of pressure and stuff if she's very sensitive. But if you work at it, she will get through this stuff. Like, it's really not a big deal. She's going to power through it if you stay confident and just stick to your guns and work on everything. You're gonna do yourself a disservice, I think, if you kind of give up on it too soon.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Let me just add that that's really great stuff because for one, shepherds are notoriously vocal, and it can seem like your dog is being killed with the tiniest amount of leash pressure. And if you're not familiar with it, it could freak you out so badly. We see so many shepherds that you put a little pressure on and they're like, wah! And you're like, oh God, and neighbors are coming out. And so it's easy to let that freak you out. And chances of that actually, the prong collar harming your dog, are slim to none to even less than slim to none. One of the things I'd love to recommend is that, so you don't have a contrast, I'd rather you have your dog wearing the leash and prong with the leash on in the house, to where you're not getting this contrast of, oh, leash and prong's going on, and it's this thing I don't like. Just have it be on constantly when you're home supervising, so the contrast fades, so the dog just gets used to the tool being on, so you don't get this thing of like, oh, here it comes, you know, right? So, and then the other part of this is that I'm not so sure that your dog's scared of the leash and prong. Right. There's a really, really good chance that your German Shepherd, at that age especially, is not really keen on being told what to do in a kind of very precise, kind of high level of precision. Like, I want you to walk just like this. I need you to be right here. I disagree with this. It's very likely that you're going to get a dog at this age, especially a shepherd, that's going to not dig that. And so the prong collar that you're interpreting as being, I don't like, might be the control I don't like. So I think there's very possibly a very different dynamic going on than what you're interpreting. The other thing I wanted to mention is that you say he's very gentle and respectful, or she's gentle and respectful. And if she's barking like a mad dog at the front door and she's highly reactive on walks, gentle and respectful don't get to go in those categories, right? She may be gentle and respectful in some other spaces, but she's showing you some really poor behavior in some other areas as well. So I try and recalibrate kind of how you look at your dog. Not that your dog's a bad dog, but just seeing your dog as like a young shepherd that's getting up to some monkey business, that's vocalizing, that's probably disagreeing with being controlled, and start to train your dog more like a dog and think and worry less about I'm hurting its feelings, or that it's uncomfortable or it's sad or something like that. Jeffrey?
You guys covered it all. I think I'm gonna just let you go with that one.
You don't wanna cry through this one?
Guys,
I'll hold you.
That was an emotional.
I'll hold you. I'll hold you if you want.
I feel bad for that. For that person.
Laura Morgan, the Shepherd Whisperer.
I love shepherds. I will say that I think you should go to e-collar soon. Definitely. And you can use our free videos on eCaller.
That's right.
You've already got the foundation DVD, so you've got so much information in there. Mm-hmm. I think just going to eCaller soon for everything will be really nice to have.
Absolutely.
Not that the prong collar is a bad thing. I really agree with Sean that the prong collar needs to be worn so that the dog's not associating the prong with walks. Because obviously the walks aren't comfortable for your dog. So if it's only like, oh, the prong collar is only coming out because we're going on a walk, dog's right. Like, you know what? I know what I do on this walk. It's not just that he's exploding because he's angry at dogs. He's exploding because he's unsure. You're not really, there haven't been any pops. There haven't been any snapping him out of his little tizzy. So he's also concerned probably about that stuff. So let's have him wearing the prong collar more, and then eventually go to eCaller. You can use our free videos. We have our DVD, but our free videos are great just for getting recall, heal, and place, which you've already done great work with the DVD.
Yeah, and I think that hopefully you can just recalibrate maybe from this whole kind of presentation how you view your dog, right? Instead of viewing your shepherd as this kind of delicate creature that's scared of a tool, view your dog as a young adolescent moving into maturity shepherd that's like, I don't like this, and I don't like being controlled, and I'm giving you a hard time on the walks, and I'm giving you a hard time at the front door. Like, maybe kind of like start to see things a little bit more, let's say accurately, but kind of accurately. So,
cool.
Hope that helps.
Awesome.
Let us know how it goes.
This just can be a little quick one.
Yeah.
Well, this is a bonus question for Tammy.
Bonus question for Miss Tammy. I have a great question.
And she does.
I'm training a Dane Mastiff mix, a very big guy, just over a year old, and he's intact. I'm using the remote trainer, prong, and dominant dog collar because some of his issues...
and a ladder.
Because of some of his issues he gave me early on.
Hydraulic lift.
One of his owner's complaints is that he pees on the other dog in the household, a boxer, as well as the owner.
That's so gross.
Did you hear that?
As well as
also the owner.
That's right. So gross.
I'm worried that if I correct with the remote collar, he will redirect on the other dog. Thoughts? Thanks.
Guys?
Can
hit
I
it.
Hit
can
it.
I say if you abuse them, you lose them? Is that an okay? To add that in there initially?
What do you mean, if you abuse them, you lose them?
This dude's intact.
Oh.
That would be
Oh. Man, look at you.
If you abuse him, you lose him. Okay. That's right.
Wow, that's a powerful statement. I don't want to see that on a bumper sticker, that's for sure.
Right. Especially in this context.
Wow, makes me a little uncomfortable. I think ready to cut the show?
All I know is if my wife ever gives me a t-shirt that says that, I'm running.
Right? You can come stay here with the good dog, right?
I'm running.
So here's what I'd suggest, right? The dog's e-collar trained, right, Laura?
Yeah, I think she's working.
As well as a multitude of other tools. Mm-hmm. So what I would do is I'd have a long line on this dog, and I would set this dog up to go on a little peeing spree next to the boxer. I think it was a boxer or whatever the older dog is. And I would correct that dog firmly, and I would make sure with the long line on that I could pull the dog away in case he was to redirect. He probably won't redirect because he's probably too tall to even reach down and bite the other dog. But mainly, I would like, that dog needs his butt handed to him from Mark. He's being a D-I-C-K, I don't know how to say that. Are we allowed to?
It's called,
if you said, abuse it, you lose it.
If you abuse, right? Maybe that gets taken off too.
If you abuse them, you lose them.
May we tie that in a knot? Anyways, so that's the, like, of the crappiest behavior, that sits atop the mountaintop of crappiest behavior. It's so freaking disrespectful. So not just peeing on the other dog,
peeing
on the owner is the most disrespectful thing in the world. So that dog needs to be corrected for both of those at a high level. Long line on that dog, let him go, oh, I'm just gonna stride over here. And then as soon as he decides it's whizzing time, boom, bang, and get that dog like done with that silliness.
Okay. Love it.
Yeah. Anybody else want to add to that? It makes me mad. Yeah. That question makes me mad.
If you abuse them, you lose them. I think we should just
right?
Not teach you.
But anybody else want to add anything?
I want to say that neutering would not fix his attitude.
No, not his attitude, but the marking and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah, certainly.
Absolutely.
A lot of that, but this is attitude.
But this
too.
Is bigger. Yeah. This is bigger than the act of testing. Urinating.
Right.
Marking.
Right.
This is bigger than that.
Right.
This is a dog that's.
Yeah.
That's a pretty powerful position to be in.
What would you do, Jeff? What would Jeff do?
I'm a huge advocate of spay and neuter. I don't see why you need to have the dog intact, especially if it's actually not using his
its
body
things
parts.
Appropriately.
Acceptable. But you absolutely have to punish this behavior. You have to punish it firmly, you've got to punish it quickly, and you've got to make it really uncomfortable for the, you know, to do this. It's never acceptable, so I can't imagine any situation where having a dog intentionally urinate on you, mark on, it's not even urinate on you, mark on you.
Boy.
The dog is literally walking up to a human being, lifting up their leg and claiming you. That's a really, and how old is this dog? If this is a younger dog, especially,
I don't know.
This is a really dangerous precedent to put this dog in. And in a way, it's unfair to the dog to allow it to get away with this, and it's absolutely unfair to the owner. A dog like that won't do well in any home if it's not.
Yeah, this dog is going to continue to become more of an a-hole and more of an a-hole.
And it won't, anybody that's, you know, the dog will grow out of it. The dog doesn't.
No,
grow
the
out
dog will grow into it.
Grow
the
into
dog
it
will get worse and worse.
Wandering at all to be able to pee on the owner,
yeah,
or be able to pee on the other,
yeah,
dog.
Yeah, Tammy, train that dog. That dog should be in place while the world, yeah, goes around. Let, yeah, teach,
you
know, that dog like.
Sure, like, it hasn't happened to Tammy.
But. No, no, but Tammy should be like locking that dog down.
Yeah.
Time for the lower lockdown.
Yeah.
And one last thing is, if there's any concern about that dog redirecting on the dog or the person,
muzzle
then
them
muzzle them up.
Muzzle them up.
Muzzle them up. Muzzle condition him if you need to do
I'd
it to make
muzzle,
sure.
I'd probably muzzle him anyway. Because mm-hmm. he has redirected.
Or you could muzzle his private parts.
You get just a dog, they make this little like boy diaper.
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah, just give him a diaper.
What do you think of that, buddy?
Yeah.
Well, boy diaper you.
Forget the boy diaper.
Have a good time with that. Anyways, guys, okay, I think we're out of here, right? Little Jeff, little fist bump.
Is that how we do it?
Tori. Guys, the All-Star crew, we've been blessed to have them with us. Hope you enjoy the show, kind of a special, cool one. We will see you guys next week.
Yep.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.